Go to the source.
And look who's here.
Let's go to the source.
Look who's here. Let's
look, you know, Jeff Goodman. Jeff, I've been trying to digest all the detail in your very comprehensive report for Stadium. I mean, this is loaded. This is loaded. Punching a player, choking an assistant, verbal abuse. I mean, racial and ethnic and racial slurs. I mean, the list goes on and on. Yeah. So, you know, actually, Jeff, before we get into your incredible reporting here when it comes to Gregg Marshall at Wichita State and also the statement that he released through his agent to you earlier, just as a longtime reporter at all levels of basketball, I just want to know, when you first started to hear about these allegations, having covered Gregg Marshall, what was your reaction when you were like, wait, what? Who? How?
So I got to turn back the clock a little bit, guys. So they go to the Final Four years ago. They go to the Final Four, and I'm on Dan Patrick's show. And Dan Patrick asked me the question, why hasn't Gregg Marshall gotten a bigger job? And I remember responding. I said, you want the truth? Yeah, I want the truth. Well, it's because Gregg Marshall isn't that well-liked within the industry. What I didn't know was, and I didn't really care, Gregg Marshall was on right behind me. They played that clip to intro Gregg Marshall. And he responded with, well, I could say the same thing about Jeff Goodman. I laughed. Who cares? I mean, true, whatever. So we've had a hot and cold relationship, but I guess what I'm trying to get at is, no, I'm not that surprised. With everything that I've heard about Gregg Marshall over the years in the industry, and anybody who's plugged into college basketball, yes, I was surprised that he punched a player, guys. Shaq Morris, who, man, I've been trying to get on the record for literally the last 6 months, and got him on the record Wednesday night at about 11 o'clock and wrote the story yesterday. And you guys know you've done the investigative thing. It takes time, right? The lawyers, all that stuff takes a while, and you're ready to go. You want the story out there. So the story hit at about midnight. The Athletic actually beat me to it, but mine was 6 months, 36 different former and current players, former and current coaches, and 34 of those had nothing good to say about Gregg Marshall, the human being. Two of them defended him. Now, everybody agrees Gregg Marshall's a hell of a basketball coach when it comes to X's and O's. But the overwhelming sentiment was Gregg Marshall makes it personal. And again, when you punch a player, and I got not only Shaq Morris on the record, but also another player, Ty Taylor, who was there on the record, five more players anonymously who are all scared because a lot of them they're kind of heroes in Wichita. You know, you guys know, I mean, like, they want to go back to Wichita. They want to make money off camp. They want to be revered, and they're scared because Gregg Marshall's a guy that's got a lot of juice in Wichita.
You know what, Jeff? We were talking about it before you came on, and I said to Michael, I said, hey, yeah, he released a statement, and Michael said that statement was a bunch of nothing. Yeah. What did you get out of the statement, and really, what read between the lines, what is he saying from that statement?
Well, the best was my coaching style isn't for everyone. I love that one. Love that one.
That's right? I highlighted that too. Yeah,
isn't it? No kidding. Your coaching style shouldn't be for anyone. Anyone. Go watch Brad Stevens. Go watch Tony Bennett. You don't have to treat people like this to be an effective basketball coach. You can be a good human being. And I think that's my biggest issue with Gregg Marshall. Again, one of the incidents was a body shaming incident. I did not name the player because the player is dealing with, depression, anxiety, mental illness. I talked to his father, and he said his son literally has stayed for 3 years down in the basement of their house and can't deal with the repercussions, everything that happened from Wichita. He's been better over the last month or so since his dad kind of talked to him about it, because now he feels like he's not the only one who dealt with all this Gregg Marshall stuff. And that's the biggest thing, guys, is it just spans so many players. I started this story just looking into the fact that he had seven players transfer, which is a large number for a school like this. And they were good players, guys averaging double figures. So I started with that. And every kid I talked to, not only did I get one story from that person, then they told me another story about another. It was the easiest story ever to do, because everybody was chomping at the bit to tell me stories. I almost had to get him off the phone. They just kept wanting to talk and tell more stories.
Wow. You know, it reminds me, I don't know if you ever seen the movie Steve Jobs, the Aaron Sorkin Steve Jobs movie with Michael Fassbender as Steve Jobs. And he's having his last argument with Steve Wozniak. And he's like, people want to know the difference between us. I say, Steve's an a-hole. And he was like, that's the difference between me. That's the difference between us, brother. He's like, it's not binary. You can be decent and good at your job at the same time. So that reminded me of of what
completely
you just said.
True.
But no, but what I'm fascinated by, though, Jeff, is like, you know, these aren't allegations and these aren't stories from, you know, yesteryear or days gone by when coaches, you know, this was maybe more common for coaches to be abusive. We've evolved quite a bit as a society and as a sporting society where this is unacceptable, and it has been for quite some time. Kudos to you for uncovering this, but why did it stay in the shadows for so long when he literally punched a player?
Winning. Mm. Winning breeds power, and power breeds fear, right? And these players, from talking to him, even Shaq Morris, who obviously does not like Gregg Marshall, just said it took him talking to the current players and understanding, talking to the current players on the team now, and that Gregg Marshall hasn't changed, to figure out that, you know what, I'm finally going to do it. And again, it's hard. Gregg Marshall's got a young kid. He played pro, but his pro career might be over. And for him, he makes money in Wichita. So there's that challenge for him of, again, people love me here. If I do this, if I go against Gregg Marshall, is Wichita, the community, the fan base, are they going to turn on me? And they may, guys. They really may. Like, listen, it's not like Wichita put out a statement earlier today before Marshall put out his. And basically the statement was, the investigation is still ongoing, and Gregg Marshall's still our coach right now. Like, we're not making a move. We're not. I thought he'd be suspended for now until they completed the investigation. They haven't. And you don't know how many coaches have hit me up today and said, he's done. 100% he's done. And I've texted him or called him and said, trust me, it's not 100%. Like, he could survive this, which is incredible. In this day and age, if you only had the Shaq Morris story, wouldn't that be enough unto itself, guys, to fire Gregg Marshall? You saw all the information, all the reporting I did. There were like 10 other things. And honestly, I kept like 25 of them out. Things like crude things that he would say. You know, he had 3 7-footers, and he would always call them 21. I've got 21 feet. You guys are 21 feet of grade A. I'm not going to say the word. You know the word. He would say it over and over and over, things of that nature. He had a player who was dating a stripper, and he would tell him, go get your stripper girlfriend off her pole and have her come here and get you. Like, things like that. I didn't even include them. They didn't make the cut. They didn't even come close to making the cut. That's how bad, you know, this story was.
Those coaches who have hit you up and you said it's not 100%, what percent is it that he survives? I mean, or that he goes. Say it that way. Percent chance that he goes.
There's a lot of money in Wichita, guys. A lot of money, right? Koch brothers are there. Tom Devlin's there. He owned Rent-A-Center. You've got... People don't understand how much money is in Wichita. The money's going to talk, potentially, guys. And if those boosters say they want Gregg Marshall still, they may get Gregg Marshall still. Like, it's the world we live in right now, right? I mean, listen, somebody told me that Gregg Marshall's tight with Mike Pompeo. I'm expecting a tweet today from, you know, who knows? Trump could tweet fake news. I don't know what to expect these days, right?
That's right. That's right. It's that crazy. It's that crazy. Yeah. Look, and you can't say, oh, that would never happen.
Right.
During these times, yes, they would. Yes, it would.
So Jeff, talk about it. And the reason, remember, I started off this conversation with just like, what was your reaction? Again, not knowing Gregg Marshall's reputation within the industry, certainly not knowing your history with him or your knowledge. But the reason I started the conversation by asking that question, and you've been at the forefront and in the center of corruption investigations throughout college and amateur basketball. And then you see coaches who, you know,
except Michael,
on the surface
Michael,
of,
yeah. Except I was told to stand down while working at our former employer at ESPN when covering the FBI investigation. So I wanted to be at the forefront, but I was told not to be. But yeah. that's for another day. That's for another day.
Right. But point being is like, you know, and thank you for sharing that. point being, you know, a coach who on the surface is an upstanding citizen and stands for the right things and has a standard, you know, and is squeaky clean, only to find out that, you know, they're cheating just like everybody else. And the common refrain is, well, everybody's doing it. We just haven't been caught yet. Yeah. But everybody's doing it on one level or the other. Or maybe there's enough distance between the coach and the people doing the dirty work. But that's just how it goes in this business. So I say that to say, and again, Gregg Marshall's history notwithstanding, or his reputation notwithstanding, I just wonder how much of this is going on, but people like you just haven't uncovered it yet. Like, how many coaches are behaving this way, but we just don't know it at this point?
All right, listen, I agree. There's definitely, I've been to Tom Izzo practices. I've been to Bill Self practices. They're not G-rated. Let's face it. They're R-rated. I mean, they're going after guys. They're dropping profanities. They're getting up in guys' faces. The difference is, and again, from talking to all these players and hearing their stories, it's personal with Gregg Marshall. Mm. Like, with Jim Calhoun, guys, every player you talk to hated playing for Jim Calhoun when they were at UConn. And every player now you talk to, every former UConn player will say, I love Jim Calhoun. With Gregg Marshall, it was the former players, the current players, the former assistants, even the current assistants, all saying, this is not a good guy. This is not a good guy. So time doesn't heal old wounds. Listen, I just got off the phone, guys, with somebody, his name, he was a player who played for Marshall at Winthrop. Dan Tollins. I haven't even written this yet. I'm going to write it probably Monday. First, he was a walk-on at Winthrop, where Gregg Marshall started his Division I career. And he said, some of the stuff going on, we didn't know any different for us, but it was basically the same stuff. He told me a story of how, like, he was his son. They invited everybody over, the whole team, for his son's, like, birthday party. Gave him a wiffle ball bat and a wiffle ball and said, hey, can you do me a favor, you know, entertain him and whatever. Don't break the wiffle ball. 10 minutes later, they broke the wiffle ball. He said Gregg Marshall came in and, quote unquote, jacked up one of the guys against the wall for breaking the wiffle ball. So, again, it's not like this is new. But I guess what I would say, Michael, what I would say is Self and Izzo have a relationship with their players, that their players know it's for their best interest. They can put their arm around them and do put their arm around them after a game. And we saw it a couple of years ago, with Tom Izzo and Aaron Henry.
Yeah, with Tom Izzo.
Went up in him. And Aaron Henry, after the game, was like, I'm good with that. Like, I'm good with that. Right. And some guys go back at Izzo and Self.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. And Michael, just to be clear, I know you got another question. Like, I'm in no way suggesting that that makes it okay. Thank you for highlighting the levels that Gregg Marshall has gone compared to just your everyday coaches. I just wonder if it's like, yo, you know, are we just not as evolved as we like to think we are when it comes to people understanding that there's just no place for that kind of abuse?